Good morning. Glad to welcome you this morning to Bethel Baptist Church. I'm glad to be here, and I'm certainly glad you're here to share together this time of worship and praise of our Lord together. May the Lord bless us and lift up the name of Jesus. And God bless us all today as we share a time of worship and praise of the Lord. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord in heaven, as we bow in thy presence, we want to thank you, Lord, today for your divine presence in the sanctuary of the Lord. I want to thank you, Lord, for all that have gathered here today in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for each person present. We ask your blessings on the service, but Lord, we ask your blessing on every person, every home and family represented here this day. And may we rejoice to know your love for us all. Thank you, Lord, today. We make this prayer in the blessed name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And Lord bless you. We continue to focus on the things of the Lord on this Lord's Day. Also, I want to share with you this basic announcement this morning. First of all, to share this update. We gave to the Baptist Home Mission Disaster Relief Fund last Sunday. I want to thank you for your offering. It was given to us for this object. We received $1,269. So we're grateful for every gift was given. We thank you for your generous support and all the special offering. And also just recognize today those who are visiting with us. We're happy that you're here. We have focused on this church day being this Sunday being a friends and family day. I encourage folks who are in the neighborhood to invite friends and family with us. So we're glad, especially for all the visitors with us today. God bless you. Glad for all the families, the regular families that are here, and all others who are here today with us today. So God bless you. Thank you very much. So let's praise the Lord together.
Oh my gosh. I'm so
we have two hymns of praise this morning at Calvary. We'll be singing the first, third, and fourth verses, and then we'll sing His Name is Wonderful. Stand, please.
Oh,
enter into our prayer time today. We want to be mindful of special needs. Continue to pray for our church as we refocus on evangelism, concern, and outreach. And want again to say thank you for all who are visitors with us today as you've come to be with us on this special occasion today. We do want to remember other special needs as well. Of course, Kathy Morris, daughters, Michaela's baby in the hospital in Asheville, as far as I know at this time. So continue to pray for Michaela's newborn baby recently. Hilda Quisnett, one of our own shut-ins dealing with the COVID. Continue to pray for all of our other shut-ins and their special needs, including especially praying for Paul Mann. We'd also like to remember Dr. Wayne Blackwood and his wife Mary, a former pastor of this church, and his wife. She has begun cancer treatment surgeries again, and also he is scheduled for surgery later in October. So continue to pray for this fine couple and thank God for the work they did in his pastoral ministry in this church in the time past. Continue also to pray for Laura Squinto as she continues in recovery from her recent surgery needs. Also continue to pray for Martha Simpson, who is scheduled for surgery on Tuesday this week. So be mindful to pray for each of these and others on your prayer list today. Let's pray together. Dear Lord, we just want to thank you, Lord, today that we may gather in the name of Jesus to share a time of worship and praise of the Lord. Help us, Lord, today to let our hearts be grateful that you love us and care so much for us. Help us, Lord, today to love you now this day more than ever. And we ask your blessings on all who are here. Again this day, Lord, we ask you to just bless all. Help us to draw close to thee. Help us to believe that you are the one who is the true Almighty God and Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Savior and Lord. Dear Lord, we pray today for Ms. Kathy Morrow's daughter, Michaela, for Michaela's baby in the hospital in Asheville. Lord, how we pray your blessings for this special need today. Bless the whole family circle around them. Lift them up and encourage your hearts today. Dear Lord, we pray today for all of our shut-ins. And Lord, we pray a special day for Ms. Hilda Wisdom, who's dealing with the COVID-19. We ask the Lord your blessing, let it be healing, strength, and a good recovery. Dear Lord, for all others we may know personally that are dealing with COVID-19, we ask, Lord, your blessing. Let them have healing. Let them be able to return to good health again. And dear Lord, we pray today for the former pastor of this church, Dr. Wayne Blackwood. We ask your blessings for him as he faces surgery. We pray for his wife, who is also beginning a new round of treatment for cancer. Lord, we ask your blessings on this special need. We thank you for the ministry and work and service in the name of the Lord this couple has had in the past here in this congregation. Bless them now, Lord, as they face this time of difficulty with their health. Dear Lord, we want to pray today for Ms. Lois Quinto. We ask your blessing for her, for strength and recovery. We thank you for others who have recently had surgeries and are now able to be back with us again at this time. We pray especially for Mr. Fisher. We thank you, Lord, we can rejoice that he's able to be with us here today. Dear Lord, we again pray for Paul Mann, asking you, Lord, your blessings for his recovery from the stroke. And Lord, as he deals with the COVID-19, bless, Lord, and have a good and complete recovery. And dear Lord, we pause just now to pray Ms. Martha Simpson as she anticipates surgery on Tuesday. Lord, may the blessing of the Lord be upon her for a successful surgery procedure and opportunity to know good health again right away. And dear Lord, again this day, we just pray your blessings on America. Dear Lord, we continue to see so many have turned away from the Lord and the church. Lord, how we pray for a great spirit of revival to break out across America. Help us, Lord, to see power of God at work in many marvelous and wonderful ways. Speak, Lord, to our hearts this day. Draw us close to thee. Forgive us of our sins, our failures, our shortcomings. Take us and use us for your honor, for your glory. For we make this prayer in the blessed name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Hymn of faith this morning is What a Friend We Have in Jesus. It's 630 in the hymnal if you'd like to follow along, otherwise it'll be on the screen. We'll sing all three verses. Stay with us.
Oh, Good Lord, in prayer. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you praising your name. We know that we do not deserve your love because we are just unworthy sinners. But we come to you this morning asking that you forgive us for our sins. We ask that you be with us this morning. Open our hearts and our ears that we may take that word and use it for our lives and spread others and show that love to the community around us. We ask too that you be with this man as he brings that word. You know what we need to know, what we need to hear. We ask that you spread that word. We ask that you be with those who are not here this morning. Father, you know their reason. It may be for sickness or for other things. We ask that you help spread that love to them as well. These things we ask in Jesus' name for his holy sake. Amen.
Why you ever chose me has always been a mystery. All my life I've been told I belong at the end of the line with all the other not quite, with all the never can it right. But it turns out they're the ones you were looking for all this time. Cause I'm just a nobody trying to tell you all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. When Moses had stage fright, and David brought a rock to a sword fight, picked 12 outsiders, nobody would have chosen, and you changed the world. But the moral of the story is, everybody's got a purpose. So when I hear that devil start talking to me, saying, who do you think you are? I say, I'm just a nobody.
very much, choir, for the message and song. I appreciate it so very much. Appreciate all that you do. Appreciate all those who help the music ministry. And may God bless you all. As we focus on God's Word today, I invite your attention to the book of Acts, chapter 16. We'll be reading verses 25 through 34. May the Lord speak to our hearts through His holy Word, divine Word of God. A word for us today. It may seem like a familiar passage of Scripture. May we focus on what God has for us on this Lord's Day. Acts chapter 16, beginning at verse 25. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God. And the prisoners heard them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken. And immediately all the doors were opened, and everyone's bands were loosed. And the keeper of the prison, awakening out of his sleep, and seeing the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing the prisoners had been fled. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, Do thyself no harm, for we are all here. Then he called for a light, sprang in, and came trembling, and fell down before Paul and Silas. And he brought them out, and said, Sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they said, Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thy house. And they spoke unto him the word of the Lord, and all that were in his house. And he took them the same hour of the night, and washed their stripes, and was baptized, he and all his house, straightway. And when he had brought them into his house, he set meat before them, and rejoiced, believing in God, with all his house. May the Lord add his blessing in reading this portion of God's holy word. All of God's word is important to us. These days we want to try to focus on a few special verses to remind us of God's love for us, an opportunity for us to rejoice in the Lord for salvation, and be a witness and help others come to know Christ. The background for this passage of Scripture and verses before what we've read in the same chapter, Paul and Silas, back all the way back up to verse 9 there, Paul had experienced what he saw, a vision of the night. A man standing out there crying out to him, Come over to Macedonia and help us. And he believed this was the word of God to him, to go into Macedonia and preach the gospel. God was calling them. So they made a way into Macedonia. They'd gone through different cities getting to Philippi, one of the major cities of the area. And so there, called to Macedonia. And they, earlier in the chapter, we talked about this on Wednesday night. So in case you, so when he's on the same Bible verses, it's not the same. But yet, it was down in Philippi, they said it was a place where they were customary going down by the riverside for prayer. And while he was down there, one by the name of Lydia, a woman, was one to Christ, gave her heart to the Lord there by the riverside. Now we look at this scripture here. Before this, our text here, we find many in opposition to what Paul and Silas are doing. We're reminded in our time, there are a lot of folks who just don't care about the Lord. A lot of folks that don't care about the Bible, the church, or Baptist preachers. But, you know, folks, today, there are people in opposition back in the Bible times. And Paul and Silas had experienced it. Every way they turned, it seemed like, wherever they were, whatever town they were in, Philippi included here, there was opposition to the message. They were sharing the message of Jesus Christ. So that opposition. Well, verse 20 says that some of the people had been stirred up there, and they brought them to the magistrates, the officials of town, and they said, These men, being Jews, do exceedingly trouble our city. Now think it. They're saying, This message about Jesus exceedingly troubles our city. So they criticized, they complained. And the magistrates said, Well, you know what, tell you what, we're going to just whip these guys, beat them, and put them in prison because of all the trouble they're causing our city. So yes, that's the background for why Paul and Silas were in prison. They're not criminals. They're not bad guys. They're guys who are just trying to answer the call of God to share the news of Jesus Christ in Philippi of Macedonia long ago. So yes, they were trying to share the message, but those people believed this message was causing a lot of trouble in the city. What it amounted to was, because some of the teachings and things they did, some of the folks were losing some money. They didn't like it. They weren't making the kind of money they did before people turned to Jesus Christ. Some fortune tellers and soothsayers and whatever other magicians or whatever's going on, making money off of it, but people turned to Jesus made a difference. Folks, today, We see a lot of stores closed down across our country because of the economy, one thing or another. What would you like to do? What would you think about if the stores started closing because things are doing evil there and they couldn't get any customers and so they just had to shut the doors? I've said it before and I'll say it again with this today. What if, for instance, what if the alcoholic beverage control system in America, in North Carolina, had just shut down because people just stopped buying their whiskey, their beer, and their wine? And just no problem with alcohol. And so they finally said they're just such a poor business that we just have to shut it down. You think some people would be upset about that? Trolling our state if enough Christians said, turn to Jesus Christ and people just stop drinking alcoholic beverages? Or what about those who are selling illegal dope in our state? If people turn to Jesus enough across our county, across our state, and illegal drugs were not being sold and somebody's profiting off of it somewhere, would they be upset when they say that Christians are troubling our city? Paul and Silas were thrown into prison because of that idea. So there they are in prison. And oh, I think it's marvelous to realize what a remarkable night this Bible tells us happened that night at the prison. You say, a remarkable night at the prison? Yes, because there Paul and Silas in prison. They're praying. They're singing praises to God. They're sharing a prayer meeting time right there in the prison cell. This is not a chaplain who's come in to pray for the prisoners. They're now prisoners themselves. You get the picture. And yet, they are singing and praising God. It's a real prayer meeting, all the way to midnight time. Now, folks, I promise you, I won't keep it to midnight today, okay? Even if we go back tonight, I'll still let you out before midnight, okay? But still, I want you to get the pattern here. At midnight, Paul and Silas were praying. They sang praises to God, and the prisoners heard them. What a witness. Now, yes, I know there's a lot of ministers today and chaplains who share the good news and the gospel with folks who are in prison. I acknowledge I've not been a part of a regular prison ministry, but I appreciate those who have. But that's what Paul and Silas were doing, not as chaplains coming in, but although they've been sharing the message of Jesus in Philippi, they've been thrown in prison because their opposition felt like the gospel message and those turning to the Bible, turning to the gospel, was causing trouble in the city. But let's see what happened that night, this remarkable night in the prison. As it's reached midnight, Paul and Silas still praying, singing praises. And then verse 26 says, suddenly there was a great earthquake. So the foundation of the prison was shaken. And immediately all the doors were opened. Now the doors were open. The bands had fallen off. They'd come loose. The prisoners were no longer held fast in the chains. It's all shaken loose. It's opened up. The midnight prayer meeting. They weren't praying for an earthquake. But for whatever reason, in the wisdom of God, God sent an earthquake. Shook the foundations of the prison. And everything opened up. But when this happened, this was just a prelude to other things that's going to happen. For when the midnight prayer meeting was shaken up by the earthquake, the man who kept the prison was about to kill himself. He saw the prison doors open. It was the custom in those days, if you were one of the guards there in charge of the prison, and then all of a sudden all the prisoners escaped, he would be held responsible, never mind how they got out. He feared he'd be held responsible. That was the custom of the time. The jailer would be held responsible for the prisoners' release and getting out. And so he said, well, rather than letting the officials come and take my life, I'll just take my life now. He drew out the sword, ready to take his own life because the prison doors were open. Then it's when the remarkable thing began to happen. Then this one's remarkable. First of all, it is remarkable that Paul and Silas in prison were praising God and singing and praying at midnight. And all I can imagine all through the evening before midnight. But yes, now then, the remarkable thing is, this man, ready to kill himself, Paul cries out from where he is, do thyself no harm, we are all here. None of the prisoners tried to escape the prison cell. We're all here. Paul said we're all here. Then the prison guard, jailer, he came in to see for himself. He came in and saw that they were all there. Whoever had been imprisoned, all were still there. He came in and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? Now, yes, pause for a moment. Think about this. It says he was waking out of sleep by the earthquake. But I believe he was awake sometime earlier in the evening when Paul and Silas were praising God and praying and just gave a testimony to the Lord there in the prison. I believe the jailer heard that. The prisoners were hearing it. He heard it. Somewhere along the line, he fell asleep. Now, I don't recommend it today, but I've been known once in a while. I've known a few folks that dropped off and dozed off during preaching service in the church. Imagine that. You never heard of that probably here. But I've known it's happened a few times in places. How about that? Can I tell you a little fun thing I happened up one time several years ago before I was pastor here? Happened up at the hospital in Gastonia. Just as I came up to the door to visit one of my church members there in the hospital. Pastor from my wife's home church came up as well. We just happened up, came from different areas of the parking lot, came up the door at the same time. And asked him who he was going to see, he told me. I said, well, I know him. It's okay if I go with you to visit him. And then I'll, that time, I'll, then I'll go visit the one I'm here to see, okay? So we went to see the man, and in the process of the conversation in the hospital room, the man, of course, had had, I'm sure, medication, one thing or another. He's sitting there in his chair, and we're talking, right, more or less his pastor's talking, and he realized the man about to doze off in the chair while he's talking to him. He called his name and said, now listen, said, I'll let you sleep through my sermon, but I'm not going to let you sit here and sleep through my visit to the hospital. So he kind of roused him up a little bit. But anyway, I'm sure the jailer had been awake to hear more of the Word of God, praises and prayers that Paul and Silas had been making. Because now then, he's not just concerned about his future as a jailer. In verse 30, he brought them out of their prison cells. Sirs, what must I do to be saved? He's now responding to what he's heard about salvation. What these men have shared as they prayed, as they worshiped God, as they sang praises. He's concerned about what's this about salvation and the joy I hear about this salvation. What about this salvation? What must I do to be saved? I want to be saved. That's what he's saying. What must I do? What must I do? And then Paul says to him, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved in thine house. If you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you can be saved. If you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and all your household, that is all your family group, if they'll believe, they can be saved. He said that's what it is. Other Bible verses teach us to share the idea. When we say believe, if we believe in Christ, it means be sorry for our sins, repent of our sins, turn away from sin, but turn to Jesus and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. What a remarkable experience, unexpected experience there in the prison cell. A remarkable night at the prison when the jailer becomes a Christian. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you shall be saved. Believe. It's that important. This is one of the Bible verses here. These two verses kind of going together. Sir, what must I do to be saved? And believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and I shall be saved in thy household. Important Bible verses that can be shared in the plan of salvation. When talking to someone, trying to witness to someone, don't have to be at the jail cell. It can be anywhere, and they can be saved. Had an experience one time, I probably told you this before, but most of you know this road goes around behind the back of Shiloh Baptist Church where I was pastor for a long time. It's like here we have had a grass parking lot where some folks could park in it, back of the church. And I stand out there talking to the deacon one day and sat on the side of the road. There's a curve right past the church and the cemetery right there, a curve around the side of the road. A car came down that road, around that curve, and he paused and turned in the driveway. Church right there. He said, you guys know where I could find a preacher for this church? And I turned around from where I was in very casual clothes, but I'm dressed in a suit. I said, well, I'm the pastor of the church here. Can I help you? And he said, can I talk to you for a few minutes? And I said, yes, sir, you can. Deacon and I ended our greetings and conversation. We'll pick up on that later. We'll have more time to talk later. The man got out of his car there at the back of the church. We began to talk, and he said, I travel this road on business often. I knew coming down, he lived up near Asheville somewhere. He said, I knew coming down the road, the Lord had a hold of my heart, and I need to get right with God. He said, I knew as I was coming down this road, I knew there was going to be a curve, I knew it was a Baptist church. When he came down this curve, I knew where there was going to be a Baptist church. And I thought, if I could find the preacher, I want to talk to him about what I need to do to be saved. And I said, well, I'm sure glad you stopped. I'm glad. Then he would realize it was not just a coincidence, I was out there talking with the deacon in the grass parking lot back of the church. We've got this special moment. Now, here comes a man down the highway. I don't even know who he is. He didn't know who I was, but he knew there was going to be a church around that curve right there. And he wanted to talk about Jesus. What can there to be saved? We talked about it. I said, now, I'm the pastor. Church is locked right now, but I got the key. And we can go inside. We can even go up into the sanctuary by the altar if you'd like to. He said, this is all right here. We can just talk right here in the grass at the back of the church. Not the front of the church, not the side, but the back of the church. Talk to him about what it takes to be saved. I said, now you want to be saved today? You want to pray about it later? What? He said, could I just be asking God right now in my heart? I said, we'll talk about it. Yes, you can do that. Just call the Lord right now. And we'll pray together. Ask God to come to your heart, to your life right now. You believe in your heart? Speak with your mouth. Jesus says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. We melt down on the grass by the air conditioning units back of the church when we were on the water sometime. We knelt down right there. Didn't even go inside the church building. But unusual. We knelt in the grass at the back of the church. And that man accepted Jesus Christ, invited him in his heart and his life. I encourage him. Now, when you go back to the church in your community up there near Asheville, you let the preacher up there know you gave your heart and your life to Jesus. Be baptized. Serve the Lord faithfully in that church. I'm sure he did that. Friends, today, a remarkable thing that happened that night at this prison. It doesn't tell us what happened to the prisoners, but Paul and Silas were released. This man said, I'll take you out. Believe in Jesus. I want to clean up the wounds where you are, where you've been whipped and beaten. Wash you. Wash off the excess blood. Clean up. Sir, I want you to know this. I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to be saved. So it says here in the scripture. So he then spoken to them the word of the Lord, more than just that word right there. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. I believe Paul went into the whole experience talking about Christ crucified, why you should believe in Jesus, and how his sin can be forgiven by the Lord Jesus Christ. All these things, when he says, so he spoken to him the word of the Lord, and to all those who are in his house, all speaking all these things. They were hearing the gospel message. Paul would tell them all. He would just use a phrase. He would tell the story of Jesus dying on the cross, rising again from the grave. And whoever believed and turned from sin, turned to this is the Savior. He came from heaven above to rescue sinners, save sinners. I believe Paul would not shorten the gospel at all. Tell the story so he could believe. And so, yes, he spoke the word of the Lord to him and all those in the house. I believe, he said, I believe. So they talked to the family. And then here's the remarkable thing. Now, you see, Paul and Silas were on one side of the fence until the earthquake, and now the man on the other side of the fence, the prison door, the jailer. But now then, he's in their house. He's in their house, and he's cleaned them up. He sets food before them, and the whole family has believed. The whole family's believed. There's rejoicing. There had been sorrow, scary situation with an earthquake, shaking the prisoner enough to shake the doors open. But now there's joy in this house, the jailer's house. So he had baptized them all straightway, the whole household. He baptized them. He brought them out to his house. He set meat before them as he gave food there, rejoicing, believing in God with all the house. The jailer took care of him. Paul and Silas had helped him come to know what it was to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. And this man and his family called upon the Lord to be saved. Called upon the Lord. They were baptized. Then after being baptized, rejoicing, believing in God, and all the family, all the household, things are different now. Now then, Paul and Silas and this jailer's family are all on the same side of the fence, shall we say. Now they're all believers in the Lord Jesus Christ. They're all saved by the grace of God. Not by the goodness of what they've done, but by the message of Jesus Christ. Salvation is now available. So we've talked about this day being a family and friends day. It's an idea of saying, folks, let's look at the household of faith, where the household is, where the family members can all believe in Jesus Christ. That's a part of what we want to be concerned about today. and ongoing in this church life, to reaching out to those who are unchurched, to say, friends, we want you to know the Lord Jesus Christ. Help tell the word, share the good news in this community. We want you to know Jesus Christ, not just to help us have a better attendance in our church. We want to do that, but we want to see you part of the kingdom of God, to know life in the Lord Jesus Christ. Believe you can be saved. Trust God. Tell someone about Jesus. Tell the whole story of Jesus, how he died on the cross. First of all, how he came from heaven, then how he ministered among the people as a man, but yet fully God, fully man. How he was crucified by those who opposed his message. Not just they opposed Paul and Silas, but how so many opposed the message of Jesus that they crucified him. Died on the cross, buried, but then on the third day he was alive again, arisen by the power of God. What a wonderful story. It's all in the Gospels. Paul knew the story. He told the story. And here this man now, in the middle of the night, after the earthquake, he's been saved, ransomed, rescued, redeemed by the power of God because he believed and trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ. He was saved. And all of that, but his whole family, his whole household, they were all saved. Saved by the grace of God. Because of this, it says there was great rejoicing. They rejoiced, believing in God, with all the family. Let us be concerned today that our families, in our county, our community, and our country, can know the joy of rejoicing in the Lord. Pause for a moment and let me say it again. I've said it in this church many times, but family life as we have known it for generations is in trouble in America because of the ideas and commitments that people are making and calling it family. It's wrong in the sight of God when we try to make a family something other than what God's Word has taught us. So friends, today we need to see the household that became a household of faith in that remarkable night from the time of the prison, the doors were shaken open. And because of prayer and praise before the foundations were shaken by the earthquake, something was shaking in the heart life of this jailer. Paul helped him to see what it was to believe in Jesus Christ. His whole family, household, became Christians. What a remarkable story, what happened that one night. But you see, over and over again through the Bible, other stories are told of people who become Christians, believing and trusting the Lord Jesus Christ. I use this scripture today, God led me to this, because we see this transition on this remarkable night at the prison, where this man is saved and his family, the whole family was saved. Yes, it can happen. Whole families today can be saved, even if no one's believers to begin with. But if you begin to see the picture of God's great love for you individually and for the rest of your family, if the family members can see it and all can accept it today, they can be saved. One, two, or more. How many is in the family? It doesn't say how many is in the family, but it just says in the house. But all in the house were saved. That's the family of God. Folks, today, if you grow up in a home that has a godly heritage, parents, grandparents, friends and neighbors around you, whatever, we're all Christians in a godly heritage. Praise the Lord and rejoice. And how about a family we see all broken up in distress, all kind of brokenness? Christ can make the difference. Christ can put it all back together. Let there be a time of joy and rejoicing. This jailer's house was not a Christian home until about midnight that night. But they turned to Jesus Christ. Paul invited them to. God was at work in their hearts and lives. And that household, that family, became a Christian family in the middle of the night. Well, folks, it doesn't matter whether it's in the middle of the night or the middle of the day or right now in this service of worship or where we might be, someone can accept the Lord Jesus Christ. Just as I spoke about that man where we knelt on the grass at the back of the church. We're praying for families and individuals to see the Lord Jesus Christ, turn to the Lord Jesus Christ and be saved. It's still true for our generation today. We ask, sir, what must I do to be saved? And the answer still is, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. Believe, trust and rely upon, draw near and depend on the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what he can do. That's what he can do. You know, we say, well, what do I have to do? You have to believe. You have to be sorry for your sin, confess your sin, turn around. That's what the believing is all about. If you believe in Jesus, then it implies turning, a change, a transformation. Turn from sin to turn to Jesus. Walk in the newness of life. Walk in a new way, the Christ way, the way Christ teaches us in his holy word. Believing, but it begins by simple faith. Trust, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. The family was saved. I believe it's quite remarkable. It's not just remarkable that there came a time for these men to pray and sing praises while they were in prison. It's pretty remarkable. The earthquake shook open the doors of the prison. But the most remarkable part of it all is how this man and his family got saved that night. God was working miracles that night in Philippi. The Philippian jailer was converted to the Lord Jesus Christ. His family, they all believed. Folks, today we need families across America, in Rutherford County, in this community of Rutherford County. We need to see families committed to Jesus Christ, asking the Lord Jesus Christ to forgive our sins because they'll believe and trust in Jesus. They'll turn from sin and turn to the Savior and live for Jesus as a new child of God, a new family for God. Folks, today, that's the message about a remarkable night at the prison. It's remarkable that, yes, there was an earthquake right at that time. But look what God did with that earthquake. So we can say today, well, earthquakes can be a bad situation. I believe I heard it one day last week. There's a rumble in South Carolina. I don't mean a fuss. I mean an earthquake. I think it only measured about 2 point something in South Carolina. But there's an earthquake in South Carolina, USA, last week. I don't know if it shook any jail doors open. But I'm just saying this, friends, today. What can God do? If we believe in Him, trust Him, we can see remarkable things take place in our homes, our hearts, our lives, our communities, as we see more people turn to Jesus. I'm not saying right now enough's going to happen to shut down the ABC stores. But with God, nothing's impossible. You think about it. Think about remarkable families turning to the Lord Jesus Christ. Where were you before today? You remember a time when you were not saved? How did you get saved? Are you here today and you've never been saved? And you say, well, preacher, I've heard this kind of stuff before, but I've never done anything about it. Would you let this be a day when you would say, I want to be saved? And I want to say to you, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you can be saved. Cling to Him, adhere to Him, turn to Him, trust Him, ask Him to forgive your sin. Save your soul. Right here today, you can be united with the family of God, the household of God, the family of God. A lot of churches are accustomed to saying, brother so-and-so for the men, sister so-and-so for the women, because we're the family of God in the church. May God help us to believe today. It is important that we make that remarkable decision to call upon the Lord, ask Him to forgive our sins and save our soul. May God help us. If there's someone in this congregation today, would you be willing to make that decision known today? To call upon the Lord while He's near. Call upon Him while He may be found. While the opportunity presents itself. Would you be willing to make that decision to honor the Lord? To let Him come to your heart, to your life this very day. Let's pray about it right now. Dear Lord in heaven, we ask your blessings, Lord, this day on this congregation. We thank you, Lord, for the remarkable night. And Paul and Silas were in the jail in Philippi. And we thank you for the story of the conversion of that Philippian jailer and his family. But Lord, now we ask that you'll bless us to see remarkable times and circumstances in this church and this community where people will come to know Jesus Christ and accept Christ as their Lord and Savior, believing and trusting in Jesus Christ. Dear Lord, how we pray may be so this very day. Is there someone here in this congregation who has never believed? And Lord, today they would say, I want to call on the name of the Lord. I believe. I believe it in my heart now as I hear this story from the Holy Bible. I'll trust in Jesus Christ. Invite Him into my heart and my life right now. Believe Him now as we pray this prayer. In a moment as we sing a closing hymn, I'll be willing to step out from where I'm seated. And I'll come to the table of the pastor. I want to be saved. Trusting Jesus, I believe. I believe. Help us all, Lord, to grow in our faith. Help us all to believe. In order for someone here today to be a new believer, give them the boldness to step out as we sing a hymn and make that commitment. For we make this prayer in the blessed name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. In a moment as we sing a hymn, the invitation is open to you to make that decision, to make it known to this congregation today that you want to be a Christian. Is God speaking to your heart? Is God opening the door? It's not midnight yet. But still, a remarkable time. There's time for you to give your heart and your life to Jesus today. Let's stand, let's sing, and God bless you. You come to the Lord.
Be with us now, for go our separate ways, and your highness that we have ordered out. I ask this in your name.